That's my ball, Mason.
Shut up.
That's my ball. Sharon, I got that from QT.
Sharon is caring.
I don't care about Sharon. That's my ball.
All right. Woo. It's good to be here. Hope you guys are glad to be here, too. Yeah, nice to see you guys. Thanks for coming. Thanks for bringing your friends and your neighbors. Did they drag you here? Or did they promise you, church is chicken?
It's a fun game, and I like fun games.
Yeah. We usually do have some fun games. Tonight's going to be fun. I don't think we got any games, but it is going to be really fun. So we're glad that you're here at the Foundry. This is a place just for you guys, and it's all done up just for you guys, and it's just really nice that we can have this place. So I wanted to just open us up in a quick word of prayer, and then we'll get going. All right, close your eyes, bow your head. Lord, thank you so much for this place, this space, and this time that we can come and meet with you, that we can learn more about you, we can meet with each other as well, that we can grow closer as friends, as people that are growing closer to you. As well, I pray that we would encourage each other, that we would strive after living for you with just a desire that just beats all the other things in our lives. We thank you so much for your presence in our lives. We do lift up people that we know that are sick and that need a special touch from you. And Jesus, we know that you are with them, and I pray that they would feel your presence and they would know that you're there, and that they would experience healing if that's what they need, just whatever touch they need. Just be with them in this special way. And bless the rest of our time together in Jesus' name. All right, well, I did say we're not going to have a game, but we do have a little bit of a game. All right, it's really kind of video-based. I'm going to play this video, and we're just going to kind of play along. It is Christmas season. Any of you listening to your Christmas carols yet?
No.
No? Okay, well, it's officially okay to play Christmas music. And so
you're
we're going to...
if you do this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, so I'm going to play this video, and it's interactive. So shout out. They're going to ask you, what is the name of the Christmas song? They're going to play you a few seconds. Just shout out your answers. It's just fun. See who knows your... who of you know your stuff. And, yeah.
I'm probably going to know all of them, because when I was with my dad, like, every, year on Christmas... we would, get, a radio, we'll all go to the living room, and we'll listen to, the Christmas radio, all day.
Oh, that's cool. A lot of stations play just Christmas music now, so that is really cool. Oh, I forgot some announcements. This order service didn't update. But anyway, okay, so next week, we'll do that first. Next week is going to be really cool. It is going to be our official Christmas party. So that is next week, right here, same time, same place. And it's going to be all kinds of fun. It's actually, we are theming it a tacky Christmas. Okay, so if you've got ugly sweaters, you can bring them. We're not really doing gift exchange, right? So you don't have to bring anything. We're going to have cookie decorations. So you get your own cookies and you get to decorate your own cookies. We're going to have a photo booth area where we're going to set up just tacky stuff for you to take pictures with. And it'll just be a lot of fun. Anything else I'm missing?
They're going to make their own ornament.
Make your own ornament.
Gonna
yes.
Get all the goodies.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. So definitely bring a friend next week. Mm-hmm. And then in 2 weeks, so really just think next week is our last youth service of 2020.
Wow.
It's kind of weird to say, but I'm kind of glad because 2021 is coming. All right. So after our party, there will be no more youth until January. Okay. So no youth service. All right. So that's the big announcements, okay? Back to the game. Here we go. All right, so just kind of say along what you think it is and just have fun. All right.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells rock. Jingle bells sway.
I got it.
Cool things. We're just going to have a great time together and celebrate the fact that we made it through 2020. So, woo for that. Okay, at this point, I've got a random video for you guys that is pretty fun. So let's go ahead and watch it.
Like a game video?
Video.
Whoa. strength. We're gonna weight lift, ear weight lift. It's on two fingers, y'all. Two fingers. Being strong and mighty and powerful, just in really strange ways. But there's ways we can be powerful on the inside as well, and that's what we're talking about tonight. So first of all, I want to just take a second to celebrate something awesome. If you remember right, in February, Pastor Rob and I went to a missions thing, and we talked about Speak the Light, and we decided as a church that we are going to commit to giving $1,000 to Speak the Light. And we thought, wow, that's really going to be a stretch, but we're gonna stretch and do it. And then 2 weeks later, the pandemic started. And we were like, oh my goodness, how are we gonna raise $1,000 in a year when we hardly have been together? Well, here's the crazy thing. We've just been consistently receiving an offering and giving and talking about it. And at the end of the year, as of tonight, for Speak the Light, just giving in this bucket when we've done various offerings week after week, we have raised $990 just by giving on Wednesday nights. Isn't that awesome?
Wow. You need 10 more dollars.
Well, you think so?
99.9999.
I think that'd be awesome. I'll put 10 more dollars in if you'll put 10 more dollars in. So,
I'll put a thousand.
So listen, here's what's awesome. Remember we did the walk for water. I know you two don't know about it, but we did a walk for water a few weeks ago. Any guesses as to how much money we raised in the walk for water? Yeah, what's your guess?
About like $445.
That'd be pretty awesome, right? What do you think?
$5 plus.
Okay, what do you think?
Probably, I'd say, in the hundreds.
Yeah, that seems reasonable. My goal was to raise $300, so we could kind of push to that last 1,000 total, you know? Y'all, we raised
$2,180. What? We just donated some of the 1,000.
So then, all together, yes, that's where you're going. We hit our Speed the Light goal and surpassed it by $2,170. So we actually wound up giving three times what we were hoping to give this year in a pandemic. Isn't that awesome? All right. So remember that Speak the Light, when we give to Speak the Light, it's that we're speeding the light of the gospel to the rest of the world. So we're telling other people about the gospel. Okay. Can y'all sit down and just pipe down just a little bit?
I'm thirsty.
Okay. So we're speeding the light of the gospel all over the world. And so tonight, I'm still going to give. Even though our goal has been met, I want to give one last time in 2020 to missions, because missions is really important to me. Whoa. To me, tonight, anything we put in that bucket is the icing on the cake, right?
We overmet it, so.
Right, we did. But this is the icing on the cake, and everybody knows the icing on the cake is the best part, right?
So more icing and a cherry on top.
Exactly.
And a fudge cake.
All right. So when we give to missions, it goes to help with audio equipment and it helps like sound equipment, like the microphone, and it also goes to help with automobiles, transportation, so the missionaries can get to the places that they need to go. And lastly, it helps with compassion needs, which is why with the Well for Water, we're giving money to build a well in Africa. Because we went over that $2,000 mark, that means there's enough money there to build one well to provide water for about 2,000 people or 1,000 people in Africa. And so that is super exciting. We've been able to do something that will be life-changing for those folks. So I'm going to go ahead and pray over this. If you have some icing that you want to give tonight, if you want to just contribute to this last missions offering of the year, this will be your opportunity to do so.
Can I do it some next week? Wednesday?
You can bring me money next week. I will always take your money.
I'll bring you $5.
That would be awesome. It'll go right to missions, not me. All right, let me go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to give one more time to speak the light. This year, we're just so thankful for all that you did through us in missions with the Walk for Water and just the various offerings that we received during the year. We pray that you would bless it and that you would get this money to the people that need it, that it would supply water, that it would supply needs, but most of all, that it would meet the need of salvation that we all have, that we all can relate to. So please bless it and bless the giver alike. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, so that's there. You can give at any point. You can come up and give now if you would like to. Okay, so we are going to talk a little bit about Christmas music tonight. We've got the whole tie in here, I promise. What is your favorite Christmas song and why? And we're going to go one at a time, raise hands. Yes.
My favorite Christmas music is The Nutcracker.
The Nutcracker, really?
Yeah.
Awesome. And why is that your favorite?
Because it has that certain ring to it, and it's very calming.
It is. It's super profound, too. Have you ever seen The Nutcracker? The actual ballet?
I have Nutcracker socks, too.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, the ballet is beautiful. Yes, what's your favorite song and why?
Why are you playing the songs? Is that rock one?
Jingle Bell Rock?
No.
Oh. Rockin' Around the Christmas Tree? Yeah. Oh, that one. I didn't know that one. That's cool.
Yeah.
You like that one. Did you like it before tonight or just that you liked it tonight? Cool. You'll have to Google it when you come on YouTube it. All right. You guys, you already went. What do you have?
Rudolph
the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Why?
Because it's cool.
Because it's cool. All right. Anyone else in the back? Favorite song? No. Christmas music?
Me.
Boo?
Yay? Me.
Just don't have a favorite. Okay. We're gonna keep moving on, okay? So tonight, I want to share with you a song that maybe you know, maybe you don't. So we're going to kick it to one more video here. All right, so pay attention. It has the lyrics on the screen.
Tired of Christmas, so rather don't deflate.
lyrics. Have you ever heard it before?
Nope.
Nope?
God, I don't like it that much.
You don't like it that much? Well, you might like it better after tonight, okay? God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen. That's the title of that song, and that's kind of a weird title, right? Kind of a strange way to put a sentence. God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen. Anybody have any idea how old this song is?
Me.
Yeah, what do you think?
1993,
that is quite ancient. What do you think?
5 years old.
5 years old? Let's ask someone else. How old do you think, Brody?
Are you talking about this version? Or
no, I'm talking about the song itself. When do you think it was written?
1800s.
What do you think, Brody?
Around.
Wow, you're kicking it old school, like A.D., B.C., old school. What do you think, Mason?
Well, since you said, like, just a song, mm-hmm. not just version.
Yep, I should have clarified. My bad.
Yeah.
I messed you up. Okay, try again.
1700s. Yeah.
Okay, so I thought this song started in the 1700s. It actually dates back to the 15th century. Which would be 1400s, which is weird, and I always get tripped up over that, but that's how it works.
How is this song that old?
How is that song this old? And I heard it, like, on the radio, like, this week, you know? It still plays. It is a very, very old song. So why on earth am I bringing up this song that's, like, almost 600 years old today in 2020? It does sound good, but I think...
Washington was born.
Yeah, it's before America even started. It's real, real old. So there's a reason for me talking about this tonight, though, because this song was written in the 15th century, and that's important to us because the 15th century was actually a super dark time in world history. Like, a lot of sad and terrible things were going on. First of all, the world had really... struggled with like a caste system. It wasn't necessarily called a caste system, but some sort of that across the world where rich people were getting richer and poor people were getting poorer, and the divide between them was getting bigger and bigger. And the thing was, when you were a part of one level, like you were a slave, you couldn't move up to being a paid servant. Or if you were a servant, you couldn't move up to being a landowner. And if you were a landowner, you couldn't move up to being a king or a dictator, or an emperor, or anything like that. You are stuck where you were born. And that's not true of us in America. Sometimes it feels like it's true of us in America, but that was legitimately true in the 15th century. And so there was a gap between the really rich and the really poor, the way they lived, the way they did stuff, and that just got bigger and bigger. So there was that going on. But then there was, yes, whoa, that's crazy. Yeah, okay, so we know that it was a super dark time, like physically. It was a very sad time in history, all right? But what else happened during that time? That the world had just recovered from the Black Plague or the Bubonic Plague. Has anybody heard of that? Historians believe that up to half of the world's population died during that time. So just to let divide the room down the line there, Zach goes this way, Brody goes that way. Y'all are dead. Y'all are still alive. Everybody's bummed. Well, you guys aren't too terribly bummed since you're dead, but y'all are still pretty bummed about half of all your friends passing, right? You know, we've been through a pandemic right now, or not quite through a pandemic right now. We're still living in that reality. But these folks had made it through, but lost half of everybody they knew. I can't imagine how difficult that would be to kind of pick up and move on after that. Plus, the plague doctors wore these insane personal protective devices. Check it out.
Beautiful.
A raven.
All right, imagine with me, just put yourself in their shoes for a second. You're super sick, you're running a temperature, there's black boils all over your body, and this guy shows up to treat you. I'd be like, peace out, dude, I'm okay. I don't want whatever you're selling. Like, go away. Are you an illusion? Am I high? Like, what's happening here, right? I'm like, what is the deal with the beak? We're like, they trying to go for super scary? What do you think, Mason?
Well, first off, if you're a high joke, technically they would probably be the ones that high because they had herbs in their beads.
You knew that. That's true. Good job, smarty pants. This evening.
That's why it's like that.
Yeah, they put herbs in the bottom of their beak so that they would breathe that in because they believed that the bubonic plague was airborne, that they could breathe it in. And so, yeah, that's exactly why they look like that. But I still think super duper scary, right?
Yeah,
so, the Black Plague, like, technically wrapped up about 1350, but they had pockets of plague for years after that, all the way into the 1600s. So it was still something that was very real in these people's minds. I don't know if you've ever met anyone who lived through the Depression. The people that lived through the Depression, they never, like, recovered from the Depression. Like, it changed the way they buy things and store things and keep things and all of that. I would imagine if you survived the Black Plague, it would change the way you think about the world. Brody, what do you think? Exactly. Yeah. So what we've done times a whole lot more people dying and lasting for 300 years. I mean, that seems like terrible, right? What do you think, Mason?
I know somebody that's going through the Great Depression.
Oh, you do? Yeah. You need to ask them about it.
Yeah, like everybody in quarantine.
Oh, yeah. It's not quite the same thing, but that's a good joke. Okay. So we had these social things going on where the rich were getting richer and the poor were getting poorer. We had the bubonic plague that was kind of wrapping up, but not completely. And then also it was a very dark time in church history. The church itself was very, first of all, it was almost entirely Catholic. And the problem with that is that they were corrupt, they were rich, and they were powerful. So this just kind of added to that feeling of disconnect that people had with each other and with their faith. To give you an idea of the size of this disconnect, in this time when people were so terribly poor and recovering from this horrible, horrible disease, the Pope decided it'd be a really cool idea to build the Sistine Chapel. I don't know if you've heard of the Sistine Chapel. It's kind of a boring building on the outside, but if you go inside, the Pope hired very, very famous artists to paint the inside, and it's just unreal. They went to so much expense. And so to think about people doing things like that, when people are starving to death and recovering from a pandemic, it's pretty mind-blowing. Yes.
Why did that city look like it was built in 1989?
That city was, parts of the city are newer. That's in Vatican City in Italy. Okay, so there was this disconnect that was happening at church. The leadership of the church was not connecting with the people of the church really well. And I don't know if you know this, but I actually grew up Catholic, and I can remember being in church and realizing that all the songs in the Catholic church were sad, like all of them. And then when I was in school and I started to learn about, as I started to learn about music theory, I realized that all the church songs in the Catholic church were written in a minor key. And we know that minor keys make us sad, and major keys make us happy. And so it was almost like that's the plan there. I don't know. But the people that were Catholic at that time, they got really tired of being sad because they'd survived this plague. They were living in this really imbalanced and unfair society. And so that sadness that they were experiencing in church felt inconsistent with what they believed about Jesus and what they believed about being a Christian. And so this is where it gets cool. Regular believers like you and me, only maybe just a little bit more talented musically, they got together and they wrote these carol ballads. And that's what this song is, this God Rest You Merry Gentlemen. It's a carol ballad. It's a Christmas carol, but it's also a song of hope and belief. And so they would write these songs, and then they would go out in the streets. They were forbidden from singing them in church, but they would take them into the streets and they would sing these songs in the streets at Christmas. So it was like this Christmas Christian rebellion of song. Isn't that cool?
Wait, Carol Baskin was the one that song?
I'm sorry, what?
Carol Baskin.
Carol Baskin. No, ballad. Oh, no, I don't know about TikTok. I'm sorry. Okay, so it was also shortly after this season that a priest, can you sit in your chair, buddy, please? It was shortly after the season that a priest named Martin Luther decided that the Catholic Church was doing a lot of things that were incongruent or out of touch with Scripture. I'm going to keep going here, okay, bud? So he decided, hey, they're doing a lot of things that are super out of touch with Scripture. The Catholic Church was adding a lot of things. And so he wrote 95 thesis statements or 95 problems that he saw in the Catholic Church, and he nailed them on the doors to the church.
Yeah,
so it was he did. It was a big time of upheaval and change in the world. At the same time, on the other side of the world, Christopher Columbus had gone to find India, but he didn't find India. What did he find?
America.
And historians call this the Columbian Exchange. The world suddenly got so much smaller and so much more different because these continents were connected together now. They've never been connected before. So everything was changing. Even though it was still dark, things were changing and people needed a song of hope. And so they felt like it was such a big deal that they needed to sing about joy and hope in their streets. And I feel like we can relate to this in 2020 a lot, right? It's been a dark, hard year. We have survived a pandemic, and the internet has made the whole world a much smaller place. If Christopher Columbus got credited with shrinking the globe, what will be said about Wi-Fi 200 years from now? Made a big impact. The world needs a song of hope and joy. And we might be the people who need to start singing. So what about the words to this song? The words say, God rest you, ye merry gentlemen. What is that about? God rest you, merry gentlemen. What do you think?
Like, put your mind to rest, you know?
Exactly. Put your mind to rest. So that one of the things we need to know before we can really get into this is that merry doesn't mean happy in Old English the way we think of it. We think of merry, it means happy, it means glad, it means good, right? But in Old English, merry actually meant mighty. And so some examples to kind of prove that to you. Robin Hood, who did he have with him? A band of merry men, right? Well, were these happy looters that were stealing from people? No, they were powerful, they were strong, they were scary, you know, they were a force to be reckoned with. You guys, can you please calm down? Thank you. Pastor Rob, will you swap with Landon, please? Pastor Rob's going to come sit next to you, okay? Because this is really important, and I want you guys to be able to hear it. So, we learn that Robin Hood's merry men are mighty, not happy. They're strong men, right? Another example would be Merry Old England. Merry Old England didn't mean it was happy Old England. It meant it was powerful Old England. Like, you don't rise up against it, as we saw with the American Revolution, right? And then the phrase, eat, drink, and be merry, we think, oh, that means party and have a good time. Well, no, that was about troops. Eat, drink, and be powerful. Be mighty so that you can defeat your enemies in battle. And so merry actually means mighty. So our song, God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen, is, hey, guys, relax. God is going to make you mighty. He's doing something powerful for you and through you. The next line says, let nothing you dismay. Basically, don't get worked up about stuff. Don't let anything get under your skin. Why? Because Christ, our Savior, has been born on Christmas Day. That changes everything. The song goes on to give us the details of that change. It says, to save us all from Satan's power, where we have gone astray, O tidings of comfort and joy. This song reminds us that whatever happens in life, whatever goes on, whether it's a pandemic or political crazy or injustice, whatever happens, our biggest problem has already been resolved. Because Jesus came to save us from our sin, from our poor choices, and from the plans of the enemy for our destruction. So this song, God Rest You Merry Gentlemen, it gives us Christmas perspective. which I feel like we really need this year. That we have this idea that though we've gone through a bad year or a hard year, we're in a dark time, or there's a plague or anything else, our biggest issue, it's been solved. Jesus, his presence is here on this planet. He came to earth, Emmanuel, his spirit is available to us, our forgiveness is free, and all that truth makes us powerful, makes us a force to be reckoned with, makes us mighty. The psalm that tonight is based on Luke 2:9-14. And I know that you guys have heard this story before. I'm sure that you've heard it before. But tonight, I want you to pretend that you've never heard it. I want you to pretend that you're a shepherd out on a hillside in the dark. I want you to imagine what it'd be like to be that. Just kind of strap your sandals on and be with those guys out in the field. Scripture says, that night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. If we pause here a second, we realize that shepherds were the dregs of society, that they were traditionally lowly, they didn't have any stature in, you know, relationship with cities and people, townspeople, all that. They were rough, they were unclean, they were even considered to be dangerous. They probably smelled like sheep, which is not a pleasant odor. But that's who God chose to tell about his son first. Pastor Rob and I went to Israel a couple years ago, and they still live like that. Like, we're driving down the road in our tour bus, and there's shepherds out in their fields with sheep, just like that guy. It's crazy. I'm like, wow, 2,000 years later, and nothing's changed for those folks, except maybe he has a phone in his pocket, you know? So imagine you're out there with these guys, and then suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of God's glory surrounded them. Realize that these people are living in a time without electricity. The only light at night came from a fire, a torch, or candlelight, or maybe an oil lamp. So when the light just burst, and is coming out of a guy, can you even imagine what that would have been like? I think about when a police officer pulls you over. None of y'all, hopefully, are getting pulled over. But what do they do at night? Shine a flashlight. You know, they do that to disorient you so that you're like, oh, my bad, what am I doing? You know? Yeah, Brody.
And they're most likely in the sky.
Yeah, most likely they were in the sky or maybe hovering down. I mean, it was just, I just can't imagine what that would have been like. And so all this brilliant light comes flying in, and there's a guy with like a 6-foot wingspan. Picture that, you know? I mean, I would be stuck on that if he had wings, which I don't know if he did or didn't, but typically angels are described as having wings. So this was, you know, a long time before electricity, and this was something entirely new. Yeah.
So one time we were coming back from Houston,
We
came back, we saw one of those big police drones.
Oh, I bet that freaked you out, and that wasn't even an angelic being. But how would you respond if this angel showed up on the scene? You'd be terrified, right? And that's exactly what they were. They were terrified. That light, that would have been disoriented. But the angel stopped and reassured them and said, don't be afraid. I don't know how to tell you this, but when people tell me, hey, don't be afraid, what does that do? Now I'm freaked out, right? There's this one time Pastor Rob and I were stuck in an elevator in Carlsbad Canyon. It's a 600-foot drop. Down to the cave, and we're coming up, and the elevator is having problems. And you know what? You don't want to have problems in an elevator that drops 650 feet to the center of the earth. Like, that's just not a thing that's enjoyable. And we're all laughing and having a good time until the elevator operator, that tells you how big of an elevator this is, the elevator operator is like, calm down, please calm down, stop making jokes. What was the exact phrase he said?
Keep it pleasant.
I was like, okay, now I'm freaked out, because the elevator guy, this is his job. He freaked out. I'm freaked out, you know? And someone says, don't be afraid. That elevates me. And so I think, man, they must have been really scared. But then the angel says, I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. This message, though it was starting with these scroungy looking shepherds, it was for all people. Everyone on the globe, past, present, and future. This good news that the angel is sharing was for us too. And so the angel goes on to say, the Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in the city of David. Now, this doesn't seem like a big deal to us today because it's always been history to us. We've heard about this over and over again in church or just in our culture. We know that Jesus was a baby who was born, who came to save men. But for the people that they were speaking to, that this angel was addressing, it was a huge deal because Jewish people had been looking forward to this and waiting on this moment for years and years and years, centuries and millennia even. It was a huge deal, a huge significance. It was the best possible news that God was stepping in to save their situation. Their sacrificial system was faulty. Their worship was inconsistent. Their hope was waning. They needed the Savior to come and restore them to God. And so the angel says, and you'll recognize him by the sign. You'll find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger. If you were upstairs on Sunday, we talked about baby Jesus burrito. That's how you'll find him. And not only was the Savior born, just like the angel described, but he was nearby. And the shepherds, these rough and unclean and even dangerous people, well, they were invited to be the very first visitors. And I think there's significance there for us, that we've been cut off from God and we're struggling to survive on our own, but we're in rough shape. But through God's plan and his grace, he made an extravagant sacrifice to invite us back into forever relationship with him. And all of that is good news, because the story doesn't end there. Of course, these shepherds, they got up and they went to see the newborn king, even in the middle of the night. And then after they met him, they shared their story with every single person who would listen to them. But it gets better, because baby Jesus grows up and he lives a sinless life. And he goes to a cross of shame and death, and he bears it so that we do not have to. He dies and he's buried and he's raised to life again on the third day, and he goes to heaven to prepare a place for us. That is the best news. That's how we can rest in him, because he's already paid the price for you. I'm pretty sure that most of you have heard all this before, but Christmas is such a good time to remember it. Christmas is not just merry. It's not just happy. Christmas is mighty, right? In the Old English, it is mighty. It is powerful. It's life-changing. And like our friends in the 15th century, it's been a tough year. We just need to be reminded of the hope of Jesus. And also, we need to remind others. I want to go ahead and do something tonight that's going to help us with this memory thing. Mary means mighty, and the fact that Jesus came to earth makes Christmas powerful for us as believers. So many times during this season, you'll hear somebody say, Merry Christmas. You know, that is a happy holidays, and that still means happy holy days, so I'm okay with that. But Merry Christmas, when people wish that, you can respond and say, Merry Christmas to you too, but hopefully you are wishing them far more than happiness. Far more than a little bit of joy on Christmas morning. Hopefully you're wishing them, you're praying that they have a powerful Christmas, that they have a mighty Christmas. We're hoping that they know the newborn king. We're praying that they experience the presence and the power of the living Savior. So as we close tonight, I want you to remember that Christmas is powerful because Jesus came as the Messiah. He brings us joy and hope in the darkest of seasons, even in 2020. You guys hear that? Even in the middle of a super hard, strange, crazy, what happens next? Do we still even remember the murder hornet's year? Jesus is still here to give us hope, and we can extend that hope to others. We can extend that joy to others. Our joy is not dependent on our circumstances. Our joy is dependent on the fact that Christ has made a way for us to have a relationship with God. So we're going to do something really special tonight to illustrate this joy and this hope, but it's going to require you guys to be really grown up. Can you act really grown up for 5 minutes?
I have no idea.
You have no idea? I bet you can, okay? So, Pastor Rob is going to go turn out the lights, and I'm going to light this candle. And this candle reminds us of the power of Christ, that he came to a very dark world and he changed our circumstance. He lit it up with his power and with his hope. And we get to participate in that hope. But one candle all by itself, it doesn't make that big of an impact on a room. We need more candles, right? And so here in a moment, we're going to pass this light of Christ from the Christ candle to me, to you. And so, should have done this before the lights were out. All right, so I'm going to illustrate this to you. Yeah, okay, just so you can see it. So if you have an empty candle, you're going to take the empty candle and touch it to the lighted candle. The lighted candle never tips, because what happens if you tip a lighted candle?
Wax pours out.
And if you're holding said candle, it will hurt, okay? And I don't want anyone to get hurt tonight. So, that's exactly why, but it can still drip through, okay? So unlighted candle goes into lighted candle. As soon as you get a light, you're gonna hold it up in front of you about a foot out, okay? Arm extended out. This is very important because some of you may have hairspray in your hair, and I want no flaming teenagers tonight, okay? I will get frowned on heavily by the board if we have flaming teenagers, okay? But we're going to do something really special here, so I'm going to need you to act as mature as you possibly can while we light these candles and we think about how the love of Jesus and the sacrifice of Jesus changes everything, lights up the dark, and makes us powerful, okay? So we're going to go ahead and pass out these candles. Yeah, we don't know what we're doing here. Okay, so you're going to hold those candles upright. If you're receiving the light, tip your candle towards the flame and then straighten it as soon as it's lit. You're going to notice here in a moment, as we pass this flame, the light in this room is going to grow stronger and stronger, because our influence in the dark world becomes greater. Okay, and straight back up. There you go. Keep it about a foot away. Hold it nice and still. It doesn't drip if you hold it still. There you go, hold it still, keep it about a foot away.
I don't know if I'm gonna do this right.
Well, I'm gonna watch you, so you're gonna do just fine. Hold it straight up. Yep, just you're not going out. Good job. Pastor Rob will keep an eye on you. Look how the room is getting brighter.
I love it.
This is exactly what Christ in us does. We brighten the room. We brighten the world. And this has been a dark year that we need some fresh power. Hold it straight up, please.
I'm shaking now.
You're all right. Okay. So remember what I said about Mary? What does Mary mean?
Mighty.
Mighty. Now, we know a song. We all know it. We wish you
a Merry Christmas.
A Merry Christmas. It means we wish you a mighty Christmas. We think of Mary in the original text, and we're actually wishing people a powerful Christmas, right? So when you hear that song, I want you to remember this moment and remember that Jesus came to deal with your biggest problem. And so everything else is small compared to that. He's lit up the dark places in our life with his power, and he extends that power to us, just like we just took that light from that candle and are passing it out to one another. Let's go ahead and seal this deal. Can you hold it for just a few more moments? You're doing so good. I'm very proud of you. All right. We're going to sing We Wish You a Merry Christmas. Okay?
It's going to be so long. It's going to go
on. You'll be okay. Just sit nice and still. Ready? Pastor Rob's going to start us.
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas.
We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Good tidings we bring to you and your kin. Good tidings for Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Let's sing it though this time, a mighty Christmas, so we can remember this message. You still doing okay?
No.
I'm shaking. All right,
one more time. We wish you a mighty Christmas. We wish you a mighty Christmas. We wish you a mighty Christmas and a Happy New Year.
We thank you, God, for this time together. Please help us to remember that Mary means mighty, and you've come in power to save us, to give us a future, and to help us live mightily as well. Amen. So we can go ahead and blow them out just one straight.
The fire alarm is suddenly going to come off.
This one did not.
It's a trick.
I can't
put it on my nose. Turn it upside down so I don't get
this. Happy birthday to you.
It don't hurt.
Well, the basket's right there. You can throw them over there. But remember, next week is our party. So bring a friend.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I need to get that
ball. And we'll see you then.
Thanks, guys.
Nope,
you're
not
taking anybody. Let's go.
Thanks,
buddy. Appreciate it.
No,
I'm not
sending them with the fire stick. Sorry, bud.
I already have candles at home.
Yeah, I can't do that. I don't want to get in trouble.
You're not
going to
eat it.
I know, Landon. All right, have a great night, guys. Thanks for being here.